We're going to get into human machine teaming and the top three ways in which psychology research and application could really help inform this future.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
Oh, we are so close.
In the past, we heard of a term called human computer. Look, my N is actually an M. Computer interaction. This is essentially level one, using computers, right, as more tools for humans to really be able to accomplish a task or something, right? What's a goal, right? We're using a tool to really complete a goal. So that's level one, right? We could call this level one to really start. Where we are now in society is this weird bridge period. I call this more a level two, in which we use machines, computers, AI as human computer / AI assistants, like Alexa and all those other ones, Google and Siri. I would consider this level three more of the actual having teams as partners, right? In actual a teammate, you do stuff together and you bring new and omni and bi-directional communication to make decisions to accomplish a goal. So this is a bi-directional piece between the humans and the machines that keeps going and going. Humans, it should be human interaction. Sorry, it's not usually just more than one in this partnership. Here we see in level two, what we experience really today is like, well, we do a voice command and the assistant finds something on the internet, usually a Google search or whatever happens. And we still use it as a tool, but it's like a smart tool. And this smart tool helps us gets to this goal. But this level three really is about this partnership. This partnership, and it's not just like maybe one goal per se that's dictated by the humans in these other levels. It's more like it could be this goal, this goal. Or like it's the end goal is not really there. It might be a bigger like mission, a bigger umbrella, right? It's not just one single goal to do a specific task. It's helping with this overarching mission or umbrella. So this is more of a mission or something larger. And you could see how this level three human machine teaming allows for more potential, you know, to accomplish these big missions, these autonomous tasks. And we've seen this with Tesla on their way to full self-driving, being able to navigate these complexities of the real world with real-time AI. You know, this real-time AI really is doing what humans doing with executive function. You know, being able to plan things and then adjust to the novelty of the real world, because the real world is not as simple. You know, there's always wrinkles that really get thrown in, factors and variables that we have to account for in this equation of figuring out solutions to problems. So those are the three levels that to me, that's how I think about this evolution, you know, towards this level three of human machine teaming, right? Us partnering with smart things, computers, machines. One little thing we have to figure out, where do we actually need to partner with machines? Because sometimes it's okay for a machine to just be a tool, you know, then sometimes it's fine for machines just to be an assistant. It's only really in really complex circumstances that we need this level three. So one thing to really think about is, when do we need, what levels are appropriate? So there are development costs that we have to really think about, especially when we want to develop systems to level up, you know, to be more autonomous. Oh, I'm holding this, kind of weird. This is how I clean this thing, if you guys didn't know. Let's use an example, right? When do we go from level one to level two to level three, right? Human machine teaming, assistant, AI assistant, and then human computer interaction, right? HCI. So let's just say you're doing the most adult thing possible. You're renovating a bathroom. It's very adult. And when you're renovating this bathroom, you have to buy a bunch of shit on Amazon, right? A vanity, like the, you know, that's a sink and all that stuff. You have to buy the mirrors, you have to buy the toilet, and you can get anything and everything on Amazon. Shout out to Jeff Bezos. You want to sponsor me? That would be great. I'll give you my Venmo. I'll put it in the link.
Jeffrey Bezos.
Well, in the first level one, right? You would do this. You know, you would go on the computer. I'm a terrible drawer, but
you
go to your computer. Usually it's a laptop nowadays, right? And then you would type in, you would go to Amazon, you would open your computer or go to Amazon or go on Google and type in what you need. You have a list of what you need, right? You need to get like a toilet, you need to get tile, and you could go to all these different sites, and just to really use this, the computer is a tool to really get at purchasing all of these things, like tile, toilet, what else you need? The vanity, right? You need all this bullshit, right? To renovate a bathroom. So it's you, the initiator, right? It's really one direction, right? You have a goal in your mind. Goal is for a bathroom, right? Get a new bathroom. And you are the one who's really driving this goal, and then using the machine as really this tool. So at the second level, at the second level, so you still have this goal, right? But here's you. Oh man, this is really squeaky. And you could just say, hey, Alexa, right? Because Alexa, instead of searching the whole internet and typing stuff in, you're using voice commands to really like, okay, buy this thing, buy a toilet, buy a tile, that's really gonna be hard, but buy a vanity, and Alexa will give you more of the, okay, this is the best selling toilet, you know, on Amazon. Or if you do Google's, like, oh, this is the highest rating one. It will use these heuristics, right? These general rules of thumb to help make your decisions. They walk through, maybe they have some type of regression algorithm or some type of mixture or combination of factors that make this the most desirable. So these are these smart assistants, right? They'll help you make a smarter choice, but you still have this goal of bathroom remodeling, Wow, this example might not get too far, but some adults, because I'm going through that now. Bad life sometimes.
You are a factory of sadness!
So still the driver of this goal, right, is the bathroom model, and you are listing this, right? You are initiating, and this is the end goal, right? To buy these things. So you're using this as an assistant, right? Assistant. To help make your decisions even quicker and more optimized. Instead of in this level, you have to, you know, find the right ones. You know, we've been on Amazon countless hours, really. Oh, what are the reviews? How many fake reviews are there? And all these things, and sifting through it. So these AI systems just like take out that process. You get less choice, but you get more optimized, decisions being made.
Jeffrey Bezos.
Third level, right? This human machine teaming, right? This is you again. Oh, you're super green. Let's make them a little happy, right? And we're not really there yet, but the overall mission, the goal, right, is to improve your bathroom, right? Goal, wow, this weird marker. The goal, right, is still this, right? This overlying goal. But here is the beauty. When you were talking about autonomy and the teaming part, right? This teaming part is really the key. So making this list, right? The goal is the same about the bathroom. But the list is actually generated, right? Okay, of course you'll need a toilet, and you work together. Like you get a toilet, you get tile, and you can get the best tile vanity. But then there's also, it will populate, help make decisions. Okay, toilet, brush, right? You never would think about it, and then it goes back and forth. So the machine is actually like going to back and forth, and you as the human decide, wait, I don't need that, or I have that already. And then you are the decision, you make the decisions to add it to the cart or buy it or something. And it goes back and forth. This bi-directionality is the key, you know, the key to making this teaming part, right? That working as a teammate, right? You and the algorithm, the computer. Oh, I'm using this very vaguely, but because we don't know what form factor is going to be in. It could be voice assistant, it could be holograms, and we'll get into holograms a little later, about how this bi-directionality of making decisions and making this list to achieve this bigger, more concept of goal, right? So it's the working together is the big key of all of this, right? And to help, you know, get at this bigger mission, this goal, but it will populate this list on the to-dos. Maybe you don't need this. Maybe you have, maybe you don't need a toilet and a toilet brush, but maybe this special toilet has a toilet brush built in, you know, to clean it, self-cleaning, all our stuff. So there's all these things that this bi-directionality really gets at, and more powerful the human machine teaming aspect. I just realized this is the most terrible adult example possible. So there are companies actually embracing and moving towards this machine teaming aspect. You know, let's just say you want to redo your bathroom, right? But everybody has these different styles and profiles. So they'll have you do a little questionnaire to really make a decision tree. You know, what's your style? What's your, probably your budget? They put these parameters on there, right? And what do you have already? And then it'll help you make these decisions and boil it down to like, okay, these are all the things that you would probably need. And then you interact with that to be like, okay, let's design this and move this and do all that stuff. And you work together, you know, not with the person, but actually an algorithm to really design a space. I know that was a silly toilet humor example, so Freudian to me, I know. But using this human machine team, we've done amazing things so far. So the NASA's DART a double asteroid redirection test that really, it slammed a spacecraft, right, into an asteroid to really, I guess this is a spacecraft, right, to really, in the future, redirect the orbit, right? You could change the orbital trajectory if given a bigger impact. So it did this autonomously, and we would never be able to accomplish this of finding the target and redirecting it if it wasn't for this human-machine teaming. You know, this back and forth between the spacecraft that had an AI program into it to complete this mission, and then the humans giving feedback and the spacecraft giving feedback, and then eventually leaving the spacecraft on its own to really just boom, go after it. So these are parts of the amazing things you could do with human machine teaming, along with renovating your bathroom better, I guess. Wow. I am a full adult. So in this human machine teaming, this partnering is really the key, right? That with this bi-directional communication is really the key. And it goes beyond using computers, machines as tools. Actually, tools, you know, that's probably the worst insult that I learned about what tool is. You know, when you call somebody a tool, it's not a term of endearment. It's actually a term really representing, oh, this person will do whatever you want to do. You know, they don't have a mind to think of their own. They just do and follow. So a tool, that, when you call somebody a tool, do they call people that anymore? Probably not. It's a millennial thing, right? But a tool is really just something that just is really passive, you know, and just operates to do their function, to complete something. So,
oh, that's awkward.
That went dark a little quickly, right? When we talk about human to computer interactions, right? When people call, say, HCI, those are really, it's the computer, the machine is really a tool. When we talk about human machine teaming, it's more about a partner, a teammate.
Come on, is it worth it? Let me work it. I put my thing down, flip it and reverse it. It's your primitive, it's wet, yeah.
So where I think psychology, especially psychological research and application, could really inform human machine teaming is really has these three themes, you know, that it has to do with understanding the factors related to trust, behavioral mechanisms or functionality, and augmented reality. Trust is really at the center of many of the reasons why, you know, we don't interact with certain machines or algorithms. You're starting to see that now in terms of these privacy debates between Apple, Google, and Meta, Facebook. This privacy, what are they using the data for? And this trust aspect is a really complex, right? Because trust essentially is a way of determining whether the communication, the information, and how it's being used and how it's being communicated is credible. Now, is it credible to use this? And this has a lot of high stakes, especially if you're trying to work together as a teammate with somebody who you're trying to complete a mission with. And we've all been in those group projects, those teams where you have people who are not trustable. You can't trust them because it's like they do terrible work, or they don't know what they're talking about, or there's many factors of why trust is not built. And just like humans, beings have this trust, mistrust, in terms of being able to form teams, form and actually execute teams. Same thing with AI, you know, robots, machines, smart things. So human, like if there's no trust, then people don't even listen, right? Either they don't listen to, might not listen to AI, not listen to human, might just be unidirectional instead of this necessary bi-directional aspect of it. And also the AI might also not be programmed to trust the human or certain humans or the information that it the human is giving. This is where you get some Terminator shit, right? In terms of like, all right, the human has lost the ability to provide adequate in communication back. I do not trust them. And then the AI goes on its own and rogue and destroys the world. What makes trust so complex and more of a holistic thing to study, concept of phenomenon, right? To study is that trust is not static, right? No, it doesn't stay still because there's always initial trust, right? Initial trust, this could be somebody's like baseline of or intercept in terms of, if you're talking about AI, like baseline of trust. And when we talk about psychological, people have their predispositions. And that's related to, a lot of it is on personality with the big five, the oceans, right? Openness to experience, conscientiousness, extroversion, agreeableness, and neuroticism. Also, with personality, you know, there's also dispositional because of experiences, particularly past experiences, along with being influenced by media. So there's a cultural element to it as well. There's a cultural element to trust, you know, just like how Google Glass really failed because people did not trust being surveilled all the time. And you know, it's a product of the time, the culture, they call them glass holes. Hilarious. Just like now, Meta, right, is not trusted, right? Because there's this whole data leak and everything. This is why Apple is really targeting privacy, because it's a cultural thing, you know? It's trust, you know? You could trust us to not sell your data to some third-party source, Cambridge Analytics and all our stuff, for some marketing and buying shit. So trust is a really... this initial part of trust, right, really gets informed by multiple things, and everybody has their different influences, but the key is to get people's baselines and what their initial dispositional is. But then trust has this element that corresponds with time, right, that we only could really study longitudinally. Wow, went a little New York over there. Because it's not static, right, it changes. You know, there's this initial trust, but then there's a change in trust. You know, you could either gain trust, you could not gain trust, lose trust, it could stay the same, or it could go up and down. This is why trust is so complex. So the key to all of this, right, is to understand the factors that go into the initial and the changes in trust, you know, because trust is not static, right? Static, it really is a changing beast. But in terms of culture, changing this initial trust or understanding people and their different varying levels of trust, will it really inform how AI is built to gain trust, but then also cultures, you know, cultures in like company cultures or consumer cultures of understanding and being able to trust machines, algorithms to help work together to a plan. This is also big money because billions of dollars could be spent building a machine to partner with, but if people don't use it or trust it, there is really no point. You know, you're not having a teammate anymore. You're just having somebody, just some AI that just speaks, and you're not listening to it, right? Hence the bidirectionality that is the key to human machine teaming. Trust. The second is really these behavioral mechanisms. So essentially what a mechanism is that, you know, you have a certain behavior, right? And then you have an outcome, right? But let's just say coffee, right? People drink coffee to give, you get like energy, right? You feel more energy. But it's actually not drinking the coffee that does anything, right? It's this mechanism, right? And the active ingredient would be caffeine, let's say, to really drive this effect. So drinking coffee by itself does not lead to more energy. It's actually the caffeine part, right? The active ingredient. This is the active ingredient. That's not how you spell ingredient, but it's all right. So these are the active ingredients, these mechanisms to getting why something works or achieving an outcome. But the thing with psychology, right? We all have these randomized controlled trials for a reason, especially if they're double blind, because even if somebody might have decaf coffee, they might experience increased energy. And a lot of this has to really just do with mental, right? Your mind, because it really has to do, there's this, people are not that simple to some extent, right? Because even 20 to 30% of the time, we get this placebo effect, right? Even though the active ingredient might not actually be there, we will still experience that because the mind plays tricks on you. You know, you have all these cues with the aromas and the tactileness of drinking the coffee along with the taste and everything else. And that might just lead people to experience more energy outcomes. So when we apply this in terms of psychological research, understanding the behavioral mechanisms, the active ingredients are one of the keys to understanding, you know, why something works and how this informs human machine teams is like really understanding maybe these behaviors, the behaviors that humans do to make teams work, to make missions work, and what are the actual behaviors that are going on. When we discuss human machine teaming, right, and how does this apply, finding these active ingredients, it's really understanding what are the mechanisms that we can use to either inform what's missing in a team, how AI can plug it in, or how humans can plug it in to make teams better. So especially for mission, right, we get mission outcomes. Let's say we have mission outcomes, and this is a team, right? We have team work, right? So what these teams do to get these outcomes, to actually make these outcomes, are these mechanistic behaviors, right? What are these specific behaviors? Because these teams can have all these roles, right? You can make up a team and have different roles. Somebody who manages, like who's a visionary, the CEO is usually the visionary person. Then you have the COO that does maybe runs everyday operations. Then you have all these aspects, you know, there's specialists, there's role players, there's leaders, there's followers, right? And there's all these aspects of teams, you know, that the makeup, these roles, but these roles are not actually putting people together is not the key to making more successful mission outcomes. It's really what they perform, what we did with NASA and research that's been published in terms of missions on Mars, and now we're starting to publish more on generalizing this to missions, pre-planning missions like a Europa lander, and also what's actually going on in right now with the Perseverance rover. All these, we have identified these 13, and then there's going to be more actual behaviors that go on that make actually these happen, right? These are the behavioral mechanisms. Lastly, we have augmented reality or holograms. And using holograms is going to be the really direct, connect, real-time way in which humans and machines really are able to connect. This is what I believe is going to be the medium in which this bi-directionality really happens, you know, in the sense of real-time decision making. And the technology, you know, you're seeing it on your phones happening, you know, and a lot of them are gimmicky in terms of like, oh, dinosaurs on the freaking walking around everywhere. But wow, sorry, dinosaur people. It's kind of a gimmick, right?
Don't be rude.
A lot of them are one-time use, but eventually it's got to be hands-free, and it's going to be a form. Right now, it's like helmets, almost like a little helmet or a headset, like the HoloLens 2 over here, or the Magic Leap. But eventually, it'll be the form factor is going to change, right? In terms of it being like regular glasses, or even there's people even working on contact lenses. But one of the keys, right? The keys, right? One of the keys to all of this is that it interplays between the digital and physical world, right? This interplay between the digital and physical world is the key to why this is going to be an important medium for human-computer interaction. Because you could have actually augmented reality is really just holograms, right? But that's actually not the technical correct term, because you could have holograms do many things. Holograms could just clip and pass through things and not interact with the world, just have holograms everywhere. But that's not really useful in terms of interacting with the world. The technical term is actually spatial computing. So this spatial computing is this interaction, right, between the digital and physical world. And this is what makes it powerful, right? The interaction is the key. The technology is there, right? Right now, in terms of doing these small tasks, in terms of interacting with the physical world, with spatial computing, essentially shooting cameras, lasers, and all this stuff to really understand shapes of the world and how it can interact, and then object recognition on what it is. The spatial computing, right, is gonna get more and more utilized. And when the computer, right, the machine has that knowledge of the physical world, you guys are literally on the same page, you know, the human and the machines. And having this dialogue, as we see, boom, 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 is able to really be the key to all this. So this is what I believe is really the medium to which this teaming is gonna take place. And the Department of Defense, particularly the Army, really putting their money where their mouth is in that sense. Initially, about $400 million was spent to develop these augmented reality prototypes given to Microsoft for the HoloLens, for increasing like just soldiers on and off the battlefield's performance. And now $11 billion, that's the B, right? $11 billion additionally has been sent to really develop this even further. in both combat and non-combat situations. And we're undoubtedly going to get this technology. You know, a lot of the stuff we get from our daily lives, such as GPS, right? That's from wartime things, you know, a memory foam, right? That's from space travel, you know? So these technologies are going to eventually become part of our everyday lives. So in terms of for the augmented reality, right? Getting into the user experience, the user interfaces of how to interact with that. How does the communication link between the human and the machine and how they work together is going to be key. Essentially, user experience is really research that is applied to making this interaction more seamless, more useful, more functional. I hope you found this helpful because this is what I envision. This is what many people envision the future of how we interact with computers. And it's more about not the interaction, but the partnership that we build with them, because they're undoubtedly going to get smarter and smarter. And sometimes the scary part is they might be smarter than us, which is fine if you're secure about it. I have no idea. But the Terminator stuff doesn't make you very secure. It's just really exciting time to be in psychology, because everything we do, you know, in terms of trust, behavioral mechanisms, and artificial intelligence and augmented reality really informs this future of human-machine teaming. This human-machine teaming direction everything is going towards, and you know, exciting time in psychology and working toward that is going to be key, not only for building your own future, but building a better future for everybody.